Thank you everyone for joining us today. Hope everybody is safe and sound. Welcome to Microsoft Reactor Livestream event. My name is Rashmita and I'm the Bengaluru Reactor event planner. I would now like to welcome Ananya Vedala, our speaker for today's session. Ananya is a Gold Microsoft Learn Student Ambassador. She's working with JP Morgan as an intern. She runs a nonprofit organization called Girls Code that works towards bridging the gender gap in the field of technology. She is an AI enthusiast with a slight fondness towards research, and she loves learning new things. Today's session will run approximately 60 minutes with Q&A session. Ananya will try answer all your questions in between or after the session. Next slide, please. Thank you. Before we get into the session, a quick word on a code of conduct. The key thing to take out here is to be respectful of other people's view, understanding of differences, and kind and considerate in the way you engage. The chat will be open throughout, and we do encourage you all to participate. If this is your first time joining Teams live session, please note there is a 30 seconds delay from speaker to audience. So feel free to post all your questions in the chat and the speaker will get back to you. But for now, I will hand over to Ananya to begin the session. Over to you, Ananya.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for the amazing introduction that you just gave me. So I'll dive right into the session without any further ado. So today I'm going to talk about natural language understanding and how you can use Lewis and integrate it into your apps and really, you know, add conversational AI to any of your apps that you want to work on. So first of all, I want to talk about what conversational AI is. But before that, there's a video that I wanted to share. Just give me a minute. I want you all to watch this video before I get in. I just want to let you all know how much of a progress has conversational AI already made.
What do I have today?
Here's what your day looks like. Today you have take a walk outside at 8 a.m., your one-on-one with Anjali at 10 a.m., lunch with Tom at noon, and your app kickoff at 3 p.m.
Go ahead and reschedule my walk to tomorrow at the same time.
Sure. I can move take a walk outside to tomorrow at 8 a.m. Is that right?
Yeah, that sounds great.
Okay, I've moved it to tomorrow.
And schedule a cram session with Nicholas and his manager from 9 to 1:30 today. And we're going to need a room in Bellevue.
Oh, okay. I'll invite Nicholas Cohn and Michelle Estes to the cram session, and I'll put your meeting in City Center 2605. Does that look good to you?
Yeah. And push back my one-on-one with Anjali to tomorrow.
All right, I've booked your meeting. And here are a couple of options to meet with Anjali Bhatt tomorrow.
Is there anything later in the day?
Let's see. How about this one?
Yeah, that'll work. And is she invited to the app kickoff this afternoon?
No, she's not on the invite.
No, please send it to her.
Okay, I've forwarded the app kickoff to Anjali Bhatt.
Great. Oh, right. After my last meeting today, I scheduled 30 minutes to pick up the birthday cake.
Sure. Pick up the birthday cake at 4 p.m. Is that right?
Yep. And remind me, where is my lunch meeting today?
Lunch with Tom is at Liberty Cafe.
What's the weather going to be like?
It'll be mostly sunny and 71 degrees at Liberty Cafe at noon today.
Can we eat outside there?
Yes. Liberty Cafe has outdoor seating.
So here I'd like to interrupt this video. So you know how she asked if we can eat outside there, and automatically the model kind of understood that what she meant was if there was outdoor seating and if it was available outside. So it's basically how when a person asks questions or asks for anything to be done, it doesn't have to be asked in a certain way. It can be asked in a lot of different ways, and the model is still expected to understand. And this is the kind of revolution that conversational AI really stands for. Okay, I'll finish the video and then we'll get back to what conversational AI is.
Can you send directions to my car?
Connecting to car skill. Sure, directions to Liberty Cafe have been sent to your car.
When's our next review with Cyrus?
Your next quarterly review with Cyrus Nafani is Tuesday, June 11th at 10 a.m.
Schedule a two-hour dry run with Benjamin McIntosh the Friday before that.
All right. Does this work for you?
Yep, that looks great.
I've scheduled your dry run with Benjamin.
Thank you.
Happy to help.
So this is a small video wherein you can see the kind of advancements that conversational AI can bring and the way it can really be used today. So coming back to the very essence of what conversational AI is. So as the name suggests, it's simply a technology that allows machines to have very natural and very human-like conversations with human beings. So when I say human-like conversations, I can be extremely vague and the model can still ask me a question back, like sort of a follow-up question, and still get what it wants and do what we expect it to do. So for example, if I take Siri, if I give it a very vague instruction, you do get a question back. Wherein you have to give a little more information, if you're unclear, you still have to tell it again and tell Siri how basically clarify things, and then you can get your things done. That sort of conversation is what conversational AI stands for. It basically runs on concepts of neural networks and machine learning as well. So that is the basic idea behind conversational AI. Now coming to natural language understanding. So conversational AI is based upon natural language understanding as well. So when I say natural language understanding, I think it'll be better if I explain it to you with the help of an example. So for example, I want a flight booked from say India to Australia, say tomorrow. So now this is the way I can put it. I can say I want a flight booked from India to Australia tomorrow. That's one way of putting it. Now I can use the same word booked in a completely different semantic sense. So I can say I want so-and-so person booked for say shoplifting or something. So when you think about it, in the first scenario, I've used it as a very neutral sentiment. Like I've asked the model to do something for me. In the second scenario, it's clearly a very negative sentiment and something extremely different has to be done in this scenario. So that sort of understanding is what natural language understanding stands for. So no matter how you put a specific word, it has to still understand how, in what context that word is being used. Now, similarly, if just a single sentence, that I want a flight booked, can be spoken in so many different ways. So humans are literally all about variations. We have so many ways of saying just a single sentence if you think about it. So I can say, book me a flight. I can say, I want a flight booked. I can say, I want to go from India to Australia tomorrow. Or I can say, I just want to travel. It can be extremely vague. And it can also have punctuation errors. It can have grammatical errors. It can be that one sentence, that one command can be said in so many other different ways. So that sort of extraction of the intention behind what you're trying to say is what natural language understanding does. So that is the idea behind natural language understanding. Also, when you talk about conversational AI, before I go into Lewis, it also helps to deploy. Like when you talk about Lewis, also it helps to deploy your final whatever model it is that you have. You're able to integrate it very seamlessly into any of your apps, and that is one aspect of conversational AI as well. It's very easily integratable. So you can also put it so in case of Lewis, when you create like a bot, finally, when you create using Microsoft Bot framework, when you create a final bot, you can easily integrate it into screens, you can easily integrate it into Teams or Facebook or Skype or anything for that matter. So that is something that also is very useful. Coming to Lewis, the language understanding intelligence service, it is a Microsoft framework which provides this conversational AI. And it provides a very easy way to really use it. However, it's not just used for conversational AI. It's also it also has other aspects to it. It helps in speech synthesis. It can be used in a lot of other aspects as well. But in this session today, we'll simply be talking about how Lewis can be used in bots and how it can be integrated with apps when you create one. So now coming to Lewis, there are certain terms that are very essential to understand before before actually getting into the demo that I have planned. So there are intents, entities, and utterances. So we'll start off with utterances. So as the name suggests, utterances are simply the way I say a certain thing. So I just now said that the word, I'm going to use the example of booking a flight throughout this session, so I hope no one minds. So that simple sentence of that simple task of getting a flight booked can be put in like so many different ways, right? So those are all your utterances. So the more diverse, so you use these utterances to train your Lewis model. So the more diverse you can make these utterances, the better it is. So generally, when these utterances are being used to train your model, like people use a lot of utterances to get a good accuracy. So when I say a lot, I just don't mean 15 to 20. I mean like people use like hundreds. They use a lot. It's better. The more you use, the better. However, it's not just about the number. It's also about the variance of those utterances. So you can either make them extremely short or very long, or make mistakes purposely, or add weird punctuations here and there, and just basically probably have words put in, like when I say book a flight, I can have the word book in the end also, like get me a flight booked. This placement of words can change. So that sort of diversity is very important when we're talking about utterances. So utterances in short are simply the way you tell or ask a model to do something for you. So there's one link that is there. I'll share that link with you all to see how differently these utterances can actually be used and how it will be helpful, like how you can make your utterances more diverse to get the outputs that you deserve, that you want. Check out that link and you'll see there's like so many different ways. So as I just said, a word placement and grammar, you can use you can make grammatical mistakes in your thing. You can probably not finish words and just leave them hanging in between. All of that really actually adds to the accuracy of your model eventually. So coming back to the next important term that is used when it comes to Lewis is your intent. So as the name suggests, again, intent is basically the intention behind what you want to do. So again, when I say I want to book a flight, my intention behind that is to book a flight. When I say I want a person booked, my intention is I probably want to report someone. So things like that. So that sort of that intention behind what you're trying to say is supposed to be able to, like, the model is supposed to be able to extract it. So in a specific chatbot, say if in a specific service that we want to create, there'll be multiple intents that we have. So today the chatbot that we will be creating is a HR bot. So with the intents that we'll be creating, one would be a leave request, because something that you ask the HR, right? So that's one of the intents. Then you have something like probably changing the leave request, or asking for remaining days in your vacation. All of those are intents, right? Those are like the things that you want to do by asking specific utterances. So every intent has its own set of utterances naturally. Like if obviously to ask for a vacation, you'll ask it in a completely different way, or to change your vacation dates, again, you have a different set of utterances. So for every intent, there's a set of utterances that you'll have to train that intent with, that the model with. And in the end, when you test your model, you're supposed to see how much confidence are you really getting that intent when you're asking a question. So that is something also that we will be seeing today. And you can also know more about intents. I'll put in this link as well. It's open. Okay. You can check out this as well. So there's also there are pre-built intents, and there's also custom intents. Today we'll be creating custom intents. Basically creating intents for to solve our specific purpose. And there's something called the none intent. So when you've created, say, 10 intents, and there's something that there's something completely alienated that a person is talking about, that automatically gets assigned to the non-intent. So say by mistake someone types something and they don't really want anything to be done. You don't want to create something as a dummy, right? So that is automatically done for you. So say there's some message that doesn't come under any of the intents, so it automatically goes under the non-intent and nothing will be performed. Or you can also customize that and get something to be done. So that is your intent. That's another term that is important. Next, coming to entities. So when you when you're asking for something to be done, the entire sentence generally is not useful, right? It's just words. There's only specific important information that has to be extracted from that utterance. When I say utterance, I mean the way you say it, the sentence that you're using to get something done. So in our case, booking a flight, the very minimal requirement for an airline representative to really book a flight would be from the place from where you would be traveling to where you'll be traveling and the time. Those would be the basic requirements. So those are your entities, because that is something that's like the important information that can be used for a task to be done. So that is extracted from the sentence that you're putting in and used wherever it has to be used to perform whatever function has to be performed. So this sort of extraction is done very seamlessly as well. Also, there's something called a hierarchy in entities. So in our case, we'll be creating the leave request. Leave request is one of the entities that one of the intent that we'll be having today. And within that intent, we'll be having dates. So from which date to which date would be one of the entities that would be required for any sort of approval to be made. So those two entities can be put under an umbrella of just date. So under the umbrella of date, you'll have to date and from date. So whenever an approval has to be made, the whole entity, like the from date and the to date, both would be required. So the entire date as an entity can be transferred at once. So that is, it's just a way to make things easier, to make the process easier. So that is entity hierarchy. When things come under the same umbrella, you can just group them up and just transfer the whole entity at once. So again, when it comes to entities also, there's common entities and custom entities. Today we'll be doing custom entities. Common entities, there'll be entities already existing. If you're trying to do a task that is already, that is very common, right? So that those entities you can use directly, you can assign them directly. So now, as to whatever I've explained till now, I'll just talk about it with these three examples. The first example I've already done, so I'm not going to get back there. So the next thing, when does your store open? So your intent is store hours and location, because that's the intention behind you asking this question. You want to know if you can go there at a specific time, maybe. And the extracted data would be open, because you want to know when it's open, right? That is the important data that could be used to get any sort of information. Again, schedule a meeting at 1 p.m. with Bob in distribution. Schedule meeting would be the intent, and extracted data 1 p.m. in Bob. So now say this utterance is something like schedule a meeting at 1 p.m. with Bob at so-and-so place. So that place would also be another entity that would be required to schedule that meeting. If that extra information is given, it can be used as an entity. So now, before I go into the chatbot, before I go into the demo that I have planned, I'd like to talk a little bit about the difference between a basic chatbot and conversational AI. So in case of a chatbot, the chatbot is very rule-based. So you can tell a chatbot, if this is what I tell you, this is what I want in return. Like if I say, if A is told you, do this. But in case of conversational AI, it's not like that. It's like a specific task has to be told, it can be told in a variety of flexible ways. And the conversational AI can still ask you follow-up questions and probably redirect you to places and get things done. So chatbots are usually like very monotonous. They're used to have conversations and probably customer support and things like that. On the other hand, conversational AI really gets things done. So That's a very important difference between chatbot and conversational AI. So now I'll get right into the demo. We'll create our first Lewis service. If you're all doing it along with me, that would be great. I'll go slowly. I don't think I'll be able to keep track of anything that. Okay, if there's any sort of questions, you guys can ask it. I'll be starting off with the demo. So first of all, you can go to the Lewis portal, portal.azure.com. So you create a new resource. It's a language understanding resource. So create. So it's better to create a new resource group right now. So let's just create a new resource group. I'll just call it I'll just call it ReactorBot for now. I'm gonna name it the same thing. It's always better to give the same authoring resource and the prediction resource. I'm just going to give Australia East for now. So once you click on review and create, you can create the resource. It'll take a couple of minutes. Won't take too long usually. We can wait for this to happen. Followed by this, we can, I think while this is happening itself, we'll go on to the Lewis portal, lewis.ai. Okay, so the resource is created. Okay, now we can go on to the. Now that we've created a resource there, we can create a new app. So when you go here, you can choose a different authoring resource. Generally, because I already have an authoring resource that's active, it's giving me the option. But you will have to you'll get this as soon as you go to the Lewis portal. You'll have to choose a new authoring resource. So I'll choose the one that I just created. So here we go ahead and create a new app. So I'm just going to stick to ReactorBot for everything right now, so there's no confusion. Prediction resource also we just created, and I'll go to the same thing. So now that our basic resources created. Now that our app is created, we've got to add utterances, intents, and entities to our app. So the first thing that we'll be doing is to create an intent. So I'll be sending a link on the group. It has a CSV sheet because it's going to take a long time to write down all of the utterances. So I'll be telling you guys what to. Yeah, so you can use this. I'll be answering all the questions in the end if that's okay. Just letting you all know. So if you guys can open that, we'll be creating two intents for now. Two intents should do. So the first intent that we can create would be a leave request. So for every intent, we'll have a set of utterances as we have just spoken about. And let's pick out for the first 15 intents from the sheet that I sent. The first 15 rows of utterances we'll be using to train the model with this intent. So So let's do that. It'll take a couple of minutes. So just click on enter every time you enter an utterance. So you see, there's like so many different ways of just asking for a vacation. So please make plans. Must go to see my parents. Because of the sharing, it's become really slow. Take the first 15 of them. Anyway, let's just stop at 12 because we'll have to probably create another one. I don't know, it's okay, I'll just go ahead. So the more the more variations there are in the utterances, the better. The better the chances that we get a good prediction in the end. So it's better to like spend a little more time and given more utterances that are really different. It's always best to not have two utterances that look the same. And it's very easy to actually get so many different variations of utterances. Okay, so now that we have 15, now what we have to do is we have to create entities. So now when you want a vacation leave, when you want to leave for a vacation, there's two things. One is from when you want the leave and to when you want the leave. Or if there's any other, if there are in some cases reasons as to why that leave is required, you can have that also as an entity. So we can create entities now. Go to entities and we can create three entities. So we can create a from date. And then I can create a need a reason as to why that vacation is being taken. I mean, if there are any reasons, since I saw in one entity that there were, this can be three entities that can be created. Now I go back to the intents and now for each of these utterances, we can assign these intents. These entities. You just click on them and just assign them directly. This takes a couple of minutes, so just bear with me. After this, we'll try and integrate this into a this service into the Microsoft Bot framework and see how we can actually use Lewis there. So now that we've created entities, I think there are some places where we didn't really create the reason entity, but I think it's going to take a while. So I'm going to ignore the reason entity for now. But otherwise, you can probably have check in at the Hilton Hotel or like go to see my parents as a reason. That would be a reason entity. You can do that. So that's how you add entities to your model. And then go on to the next intent. So let's create the next intent. Let's call this remaining vacation days. That'll be the next intent. Since it's already going to be 7:36, it's already going to be 7:40. Let's train the model with this intent, and we'll see the confidence score that comes when we ask, when we test it. So for now, let's train. Let's just see the confidence level score that comes when we give a new utterance. So let's pick a new utterance that we haven't given before. Okay. The train has completed. Let's test it. This is a completely new utterance that we haven't given the model before. So there's two now. There's already a, see, it has given a 99.5% confidence score. So that is a very good score for what we have given. So it's clearly a leave request intent, right? So on the other hand, if I give something really random, it has to give me a none. It gave me a none with a really good confidence score again. So if you have more intents and you have something more inclined towards that intent, you'll get a really good confidence score for that intent. Since it's taking a couple of minutes to create it, I'm not creating another intent, but that's how you do it essentially. So you again go to intents, you go to create an intent, and then add utterances to each of the intents, and then add entities to them, train it, and then test it. So that's how you do it. Now, what we can do is we can try to integrate this with the Microsoft Bot framework. So first of all, to do that, we've got to publish the bot. So these endpoints can also be used, I mean, these keys can also be used in your apps when you create like web apps and all of that. But as to see a to see it in the bot framework emulator, I'll be using it with the Microsoft bot framework right now. So here I'll talk about how you create it. Okay, so now we're going to create one from scratch. So now what we have to do here is, again, we've got to add a trigger. So what a trigger is that whenever these specific phrases, not exactly these specific phrases, but now that we'll be adding a Lewis, we'll be adding the Lewis service to this, anything related to, like, basically anything even close to how we are giving our utterances is are given, that trigger is called, I mean, it gets, the trigger is called, and we get the response that we want for that specific intent. So this has to be intent recognized. Let's call this. So we've got to do the same thing again over here. So add trigger phrases to this. I won't add too many this time. Oh, sorry. That's going to take me a moment. I'll just take like 10 this time and I'll do it. So these are some for now. I mean, I'm keeping it really, the more utterances you give, the better the model will actually predict. That's the reason why I'm stressing on giving more utterances to these models. I'm going to submit this. So now I've created a trigger. So whenever the intent that's recognized is leave request, probably let's say I'll send a response and let the response be okay. After this, we can add. So now there's two intents. There's also greeting intent. let's create our own greeting intent. Just making it extremely random. Okay. I'm gonna call it great. So now what we have to do is we have to add the Lewis authoring key, which we're going to get over here at the place where we created this. We've got to go to the authoring resource, and you can take any of this. I'll take the primary key. We took Australia. Yeah. So that should do. Okay, I just realized. Okay. So I'm going to start the bot. I don't think we added a trigger for the grid, which we should have. Let's do that. So you can add a lot of functionality to, you can do a lot of things when the specific intent is recognized. It's going to take a couple of minutes for that to happen. So once the bot is, once it starts running, we can check on the bot emulator, and we can see if whenever we give a specific utterance, we can see the kind of response that we get. This is basically done by Lewis, and the new utterance that we're going to give to test it is also going to be very different from what we've actually run the model with. So that's where conversational AI is coming into the picture. While this is happening, I think we can check out the questions. Yeah, there's actually a lot of languages that are there in the Lewis framework. You can go and check it out. It's going to be there in the Microsoft documentation. There's a lot of languages that can be integrated in. Yeah, see, at the end of the day, whatever utterance that is given, from that utterance, what the bot will do is it will have to take out specific entities, like what is required, the extraction of specific entities, right? So even if the whole sentence is a subset of a long string, if the required entities are there in that subset, it'll still go ahead and do whatever it has to do. In case the required entities are not there in that subset, it's going to probably ask a follow-up question to get those entities and perform whatever function that has to be performed. But it depends on the kind of utterances you really run your model with also. The more diverse they are, the easier it's going to be for the model to recognize the kind of intent that you're aiming for. Taking longer than usual. Let's try a different. Let's try this bot. This is basically everything is the same. Let's see if this is running. For some reason, that's not running. I think it's a bandwidth issue. Yeah, it seems like a bandwidth issue itself. But once the bot starts running, we can open it in the bot emulator. And okay, it's running. That's good. So you can just say test in emulator. Copy this. Connect. So let's take a new utterance that we haven't used to train the bot, and let's see what we get as a response. So we use it only till 8, I believe. So let's take the 11th one. Yeah, so see, it says your request has been acknowledged. So it has recognized the intent that we want. It's a vacation request intent, and it has given the response that we had expected it to. So even if I say like something like, I've already said, hey, say something like, I've already used everything, but let's see what comes. Could also be a none intent if it doesn't understand. Yeah, so probably went into a none intent, but if I say, I'm sorry, this doesn't, there's no, this is a different model that I had. This is a different bot which I ran. So it doesn't have the greeting intent which we created. So I probably created an intent with how many remaining vacation dates in that bot. So let's see if that, if we can use that. How many days, how many remaining vacation days? I believe that this was one of the intents that I added when I was training this bot. Yeah, so we will let you know is the response to this intent. So, yeah, so that was basically how it recognizes the intent and gives you a response. So there were only two intents in this bot. One was requesting for a vacation, and other one was how many remaining vacation days. Let's just to make it a little clear. See, there's only two intents. There's vacation request and remaining vacation days. So with this, the responses we will let you know. And thus, when I asked for how many vacation dates are left, we got a response that said we will let you know. So yeah, with that, my demo ends here. That is what I had in mind to talk about. Okay. You can probably stop sharing my screen. Can I do that? Okay. See, the very idea of conversational AI is for it to understand the intent behind the sentence. So that's what I said when I said when I used the example of booking the flight booked example. I said when you can use the same the word booked. That's also a substring of the entire sentence if you think about it. So if I say I want it booked, I want a flight booked. It's a very neutral sentiment. When I say I want a person booked for something that they've done, it's a negative sentiment. So that sort of negative that sort of sentiment can also be extracted from a sentence. So definitely, when even if there are two same substrings in a sentence, if the sentiments are different, it will definitely be able to recognize that difference. So yeah, are these the only questions? If you guys have any more questions, you can always ask. I think we have another 7 minutes. I can answer them. Also, I hope everyone has received the all the links that I wanted to provide. You can always reach out to me on LinkedIn, and I'll be happy to help. Before I end the session, we'll just. Thank you so much for everyone who joined the session today. I'd like to hand it over to Rashmika ma'am.
Hi, thanks Ananya. I think there's two last questions from Shriram, if you would like to take those questions before we end the session.
Yeah, sure, I'll do that. So for now, this is
generally it's done manually. I'm personally not sure about how it's automated, but that is something I also wanted to look into. I wanted to before the session, but I didn't really get the time, but I should have. I think that there should be some sort of a process to automate it for sure. I'll look it up and I'll reach out. You can reach out to me on LinkedIn and I'll also do my research and let you know about the automated process. But generally, I've done it manually so far, so that's all I know about.
Thank you, Ananya, for the session, and thank you all for joining us today. I have shared the link and the event code for the feedback survey in the chat. Do send your response. It will help us curate topics that better suits our audiences. Also, if you would like to watch this session, a recording will be uploaded to our YouTube channel in the coming days. And for more sessions like this, please visit our Reactor Bengaluru website link. Thank you, Ananya, and thank you, everyone, once again. Good evening.